What is a magnetic spin vortex? Most people are aware that when you look at the effects of a magnetic field under a magnetic viewer, it looks something like this. However, most people are not aware that every permanent magnet emits a spinning vortex from its north and south poles. The actual spin vortex looks similar to this diagram. The north produces a counterclockwise spin, while the south a clockwise spin. What determines whether one side of the magnet attracts another is actually its directional spin. Opposite directional vortex spins will attract, while like directional vortex spins will repel. What we think of as north and south poles are really clockwise and counterclockwise vortex spins emitted by the magnet. This is what the field of SPINTRONICS is all about. The Earth itself is a giant magnet moving through space, and everything on it exhibits spin, from the currents of the ocean to the jet stream, to the age rings of a tree. If you look for it, everything in nature exhibits spin. Tornadoes tend to rotate counterclockwise in the northern hemisphere and clockwise in the southern hemisphere. However, the opposite can occur, which undercuts the common misconception. A tornado's directional spin is actually a result of the Coriolis force. There's also the common misconception that a drain north of the equator will create a counterclockwise vortex and south of the equator a clockwise vortex. This is not always the case. What's interesting to note, though, is that all things in nature exhibit spin. And not only nature. Spin is the nature of the universe itself. All matter is made up of forces, or force fields, if you will, whether they be electrical, gravitational, or magnetic, or understood as resonance or vibrational forces and frequency. They all share a semblance to magnetic fields and the commonality of spins. Particles in matter itself all exhibit spin, whether it's microscopic or on a cosmic scale. But I digress. What does all of this have to do with the magnetic spin vortex? I've laid all of this out to explain that everything in nature at a molecular level already exhibits continuous spin. So it's not so much a matter of getting a magnetic structure to spin. The individual magnets are already spinning on a molecular level. So understanding the spin vortex of a magnet places you one step closer to building a magnet motive force closed loop system. The idea of tapping the magnetic spin vortex for a closed loop system has been around for a while. Before I present some ideas on how this might be done, let me show you some ways it can't, and also share an interesting design idea by David Hamill. Hamill's magnetic motor utilizes the magnetic spin vortex and gravity in his design. People have been trying to oversimplify his design into something like this, which has been called the Hamill spinner. The first one I saw was presented by George Green in Project Camelot. If you really study the simplified design, it's actually not making use of the spin vortex, which I'll explain in a moment. It looks really interesting at first glance, but it isn't really accomplishing what it seems to be. In this video, he calls the process spin vortexing. I enjoyed his video, but respectfully disagree with his analysis. He's presenting essentially the same theory as John Bedini. According to Bedini, by placing the magnets in a ring with all the north poles facing in, the spins of the individual magnets form one large spin vortex. Bedini also states that this configuration forms a vortex above the ring magnet arrangement and another below it. Additionally, by flipping the ring, he states that the spinner will switch from a clockwise to a counterclockwise rotation due to the spins emanating from the ring magnet arrangement producing a clockwise rotation in one direction and a counterclockwise rotation in the other. I respectfully disagree with all three points, with the emphasis on respectfully. I have a great deal of respect for John Bedini and his research, but I believe his conclusions in this case to be incorrect, and here's why. You can actually induce rotation of a spinner in clockwise or counterclockwise rotation without flipping the ring magnet arrangement around, regardless of whether you use John Bedini's closed ring configuration or George Green's open ring configuration. To further illustrate my point, you don't need a ring magnet configuration to get the spinner to rotate. Any simple magnet will do. So it's not the configuration at all that's causing the spinner to spin. It's also of note, the spinner will not rotate if you don't continue to move the ring magnet around. If you place it in a stationary position, the spinner won't spin at all. If you move it to induce rotation, it will cease spinning shortly after you discontinue manually manipulating the magnetic field between the spinner and the ring magnets. Configuring the magnets in this way does not create a vortex above and below the magnetic ring assembly. Magnetic vortices are in the same place they would be if you didn't arrange them into the ring, directly above and below each magnet. So the magnetic vortices are actually concentrated in the center of the ring, not above and below it. David Hamill understood this. In his design, he placed a ring magnet assembly inside of a larger ring magnet assembly, so that the magnetic vortices would be facing each other. If these magnetic ring magnet arrangements were actually creating a vortex above and below the ring, what would happen if you placed the ring vortex in close proximity to another ring vortex? If one ring was held stationary, would it not induce spin in the ring that was held by a string above it? What if you used two rings, one above and one below? What if you imbalanced the rings so that their spin vortices could not line up? It's quite obvious that there's not a spin vortex being created above or below the ring magnet arrangements. Regardless of whether you use a closed ring configuration or removed one magnet from the assembly, as demonstrated in George Green's version, every version I presented here would spin for a short time when introduced to a magnetic field and then slow to a dead stop. To conclude, the reason the spinner rotates is simply due to the fact that when you place the magnet on the steel ball, it can't move in a direct path toward the ring magnets. And since the ball can't roll with a magnet attached to it, it has to turn. Therefore, it will spin toward whatever side of the magnetic arrangement is placed in the closest proximity to the magnet on the spinner. These spinners are little more than toys, fun to play around with, but they don't conclusively prove or demonstrate anything other than simple magnetic attraction. Now, I don't say that disrespectfully. I actually enjoyed all of the videos demonstrating the spinner. I'm only clarifying what the spinner is actually doing in all of these experiments to lay out some groundwork for how a magnetic spin vortex works. Sometimes, to blaze down new paths, you first have to shatter the misconceptions. Now here's a channel I highly recommend. If you have a real interest in magnetics, you're probably not going to find a better YouTube channel on the subject. I'd suggest going through his entire selection of magnetics videos, and there's a whole video devoted to the spin vortex. This is another channel I'll recommend. It also has a couple of videos on the spin vortex. He uses an electrical charge in conjunction with a magnet to demonstrate the spin vortex though, so it's not a conclusive demonstration, but interesting all the same. So in my final analysis, there's a very simple reason why the magnetic spin vortex is of great importance in the field of permanent magnet motive force systems. Namely, if you assembled a rotor with just the right ferromagnetic, paramagnetic, or diamagnetic material, you could place it in the path of a strong magnetic field and it would ride the magnetic spin vortex like a windmill rides the wind. Food for thought. Thanks for watching. Do great things.